It is getting really, really hot today. Wow. Things are heating up big time. October, the month of momentum. Take it seriously. Take it totally seriously. You won't regret it. Videos have gotten more serious recently because it's a matter of taking it seriously and realizing the future has consequences we don't want to experience and we shouldn't have to experience them. Remember, existence is merciless. So if we allow our future to be controlled by belief and time, you know, we will suffer the consequences of the future. We are in the crosshairs of the future. Whereas if we decide to choose a new idea, if we decide to give our future over to the grace of God, then we don't need to suffer any consequences of the future. Because truth, reality knows what reality is, which is what we are, doesn't need any future, doesn't need to suffer any consequences. It's never done anything wrong. It's not ignorant. It's not needing correction. It doesn't need healing. It doesn't need lessons. Doesn't need trauma, doesn't need laws, doesn't need aging, doesn't need death, doesn't need retribution or reparation, doesn't need crucifixion, doesn't need torture, doesn't need destitution, doesn't need drama, doesn't need heroism, doesn't need any of that. Absolutely doesn't need anything. It doesn't need anything that arises in existence, doesn't need any of it. Every last thing that's ever arisen in existence, reality has not the slightest use for. And never will. And since we are reality as well, I am what I am is reality. What I am is reality. Isness is reality. I am is reality. We don't need it either. We don't need any of it. We don't need a single thing that's ever arisen in existence. We don't need the existence at all. We have zero use for it. None. Never have and never will. And yet, we seem to, you know, be staring at the future. And we are. We're staring at the future. And some of us who are pretty good at observing have noticed a lot of things about the future, what's coming. And realize that there's a whole bunch of trouble coming. A whole bunch of consequences coming. And we've been sold, most have been sold, that this is something essential for our development. Remember, what we are doesn't need any development. All of this is 100% a waste of time. We don't need any of it. We don't need any development. What does isness need development? Does being need development? Is reality already is, it's always been. Does it need development? Does that isness need developing? The answer is no. If you experience it for just an instant, you'd know for sure it doesn't need any developing. So let us not sell ourselves on this fanciful tale that the future is, you know, one of wonderful development and evolvement and all stuff. Isness doesn't need to evolve, doesn't need any evolvement. Doesn't need any evolution. And yet we're being led down the primrose path, being told that we have this incredible opportunity to evolve. That is so upside down and backwards, it's almost humorous. The whole thing about the real spiritual path is the realization we don't need to evolve. We're perfect as already. We've always been flawless and perfect. We need to function as we were created to function, but that's not evolving. That is dropping this crazy dream that we were engaged with, this idea of being prime creator, becoming prime creator. That is an insane dream that we're dreaming. Drop going beyond belief, going beyond time, experiencing the isness, and realizing it's always been perfect. We never had to have this dream at all. Dream was entirely unnecessary. It was necessary only because in order to entertain the idea of being prime creator, all ideas have effects, and so this idea had the effect, is this dream. Hypothetical scenario is the effect of the desire to be prime creator. And in this hypothetical scenario, you know, it's really crazy. But you can break it down into its essential elements, and it becomes pretty simple. We don't need it to be what we are. Nobody needs it to be what they are. There's nothing, no aspect of being. Being doesn't need any of it. Never has, never will. So we are being sold this story about the future, how wonderful it's going to be, and how important it is that we continue on with time and the consequences of doing that. And it's all for our good, all for our upliftment, and all this stuff. Total pack of lies. You know, just a ridiculous belief. Belief believing in belief. What is going to happen is severe trauma. An entire massive laundry list of traumatic events, one after the other. Just knocking us around, buffeting us. And you know, it's like being thrown into a blender. You know, what happens is someone's going to, you know, the blender's going to be turned on and the whole thing is just going to be blended, pureed. Existence is going to, and this planet is going to be pureed. All the while we're saying, yeah, this is great. This sacrifice is going to bring about what we want. And okay, that's complete lunacy. And yet we believe it. And I've been trying to point out why we believe it. Of course we believe it. But let's not say we believe it. Let's say belief believes it. Okay, let's start distancing ourselves from belief by saying that belief believes it. That is very true. Belief does believe it. But we are not belief. We're not a product of belief. We're not a child of belief. Belief believes we are a child of, we are a child of belief. It tries to pin that on us. And we have to push that back and say, no, we are not a child of belief. We're a child of reality, of isness. And I couldn't speak the way I'm speaking here if I believed I was a child of belief. Because belief would tell me to go jump off a bridge or something, you know. Which it has, you know, tried many things, told me many things to destroy myself, you know. And I say, well, you know, you, who are you to tell me what to do? I'm not your child, you see. Belief thinks it's giving good advice, you know. If you go against belief, that belief says, well, you need to destroy yourself because that will help everyone else out. I say, no, not true. Not true. We are the child of isness, not the child of belief. Okay, so that isness is still there. We're just hypnotized by belief. We're afraid to be in the presence of isness. We're afraid of it. Just admit it. We're afraid of it. We're uncomfortable. We're not sure about it. We think we might be missing out on something. Missing out on some development if we do that. You know, if we hang out with Ramana Maharshi for 5 years, just sitting there silently, we think we're missing out on some development, a very important development, which is not true. What we'll realize is what we are doesn't need any development. We don't have to suffer the consequences of what is coming. We don't have to delude ourselves about those consequences either. Those who believe that in the belief's plan of salvation, which is to develop a super weapon that can threaten reality with destruction and force the prime creator to change reality and make us prime creator, those who believe in that, they're always painting a picture of the future, which is one of fulfillment and success and happiness and a golden age and everything working out. They're always painting that picture constantly. And yet what really happens in existence is nonstop loss, suffering, trauma, destruction, death, nonstop. Everything gets crushed. That's what actually happens. And yet that doesn't stop the picture painters from, you know, painting a beautiful picture of peace on earth, heaven on earth, everything is going to be great. Why do we need heaven on earth? What we are, isness, already is heaven. We need just to accept that the heaven that is already here, everywhere, that is, the heaven that is. It doesn't require our world. Isness itself is life. Living light is life. We don't need to do anything with belief. We don't need to do anything with a dream. We don't have to establish heaven in a dream. We need to awaken from the dream, realize it is a dream. We don't need to establish or do anything in the dream. We don't need to develop in the dream. We don't need to improve. We don't need to learn, progress, evolve, nothing. Simply realize it is a dream. Simply step beyond belief. It's just a belief system. We are, and this belief system believes that we are the product of that belief system, that we too are just a belief. That is not true. That is not true. And yet that is the overwhelming, you know, zeitgeist of the times, is that we are simply a product. We are a belief. That's it. If you believe that, you will so certainly be led down the primrose path to trauma and loss and sacrifice and death and all of that, without a doubt. All the while believing that you're going towards some glorious destiny. You know, flowers along the pathway and a beautiful song as you walk along. The Pied Piper is leading you into the future, into the consequences of the future. And of course, the worse it is, the more flowers we throw up on the path and the more songs we sing, you know, just to try and distract us. We're looking and say, wait a minute, it seems like we're walking into a, you know, into a buzzsaw, you know, and then someone will say, oh, but, you know, listen to the beautiful song. Don't worry about that, what you're seeing. That can't be right. You're just in a state of illusion. You need to listen to this beautiful song, beautiful melodies. Look at all the flowers and the beautiful flower girls and flower people that are got the flowers in their hair and the beautiful clothes they're wearing and the beautiful music and the flutes, and everyone's, you know, walking on this path into the future, into the consequences, which is what the future is. Future is full of nothing but consequences to belief, to what you believe you are, to what belief believes you are. See, belief has a belief of what we are, what isness is, and it's that belief in what we are that is suffers the consequences. You know, what we really are doesn't suffer any consequences, but the belief in what we are, it just gets ceaselessly thrashed. All in the name of empowering this mythical power that we believe will arise one day and be able to be more powerful than reality. And this is all just complete make-believe. There is no such power will ever arise. So belief just keeps beating itself up, beating up its own self-concepts, ceaselessly devouring itself. And, you know, we're watching this movie and believing it's true, you know, buying into it. We got no choice. If we desire to be prime creator, we have to buy into this, you know. So, yeah, we're the witness, but we're transfixed by it. And we assume this is important and this is happening to us, you know. And so it's like a nightmare. It's like, you know, when the dreamer has a nightmare, who suffers from the nightmare? Is it the figures in the dream or the dreamer? I think, you know, it's kind of like the dreamer is suffering a nightmare. Kind of you wake up and you're breathing like, oh my gosh, that was horrible. Terrible nightmare. Again, existence just has a self-concept, a belief in isness, a belief in isness, and then it attacks that belief, and it symbolizes that belief. It has all these symbols that symbolize its belief in isness, symbolic selves, symbolic identity, all this, and then mows it down, sets them up, mows them down, like that, and then assesses its capacity to do that. You know, how efficient, how fast, how vicious, all this stuff. And of course, belief is going to believe that we're going towards a golden time because it believes it can succeed. So it just assumes, yeah, you know, belief just assumes it's going to succeed at what it's doing. It has to. That is the nature of belief. It believes that it will succeed in its goal. So belief does believe that we're going towards some, you know, really wow, great peace and harmony and love and golden age and stuff. It just leaves out the point of the massive trauma that it's using to try and empower that golden age, right? What is the foundation the golden age supposedly built upon? Well, it's built upon the notion that this huge bundle of trauma that's coming up is going to somehow be the power that activates the super weapon. And once we have the super weapon, our troubles are over, because God will have to make us prime creator. So it's based on that assumption. It's based on an assumption. It's based on a belief. Don't trust in beliefs. Beliefs are inherently untrustworthy. Inherently untrustworthy. All the while, the isness, the I am presence of isness, is simply there each moment. It's here every single moment. It's experiencing every single moment peacefully. It's all peace, no consequence to it. No consequence. Nothing but pure richness. Even though it's not in the dream, it can still somehow experience pure richness. It's there every instant. It's never been not experiencing. Yet the belief in isness is being trampled underfoot continuously. So we do not need to experience the consequences of the future at all. So we have to ask, well, how can we then not experience the consequences of the future, is the question. And I've brought out several ways that this can happen. Is we choose a new idea, and we simply abide in the I am presence of isness through the effect of unconditional love, and we will not experience any loss or trauma whatsoever. Nothing, because nothing can happen to that experience. That experience cannot be touched by belief. Or we can, again, surrender our future to the grace of God, and then only get back that which is non-traumatic, no loss, nothing that is fearful, and then we will experience that. And that will quickly bring us to stepping beyond belief, too. So that might be seen as kind of an intermediate step for most people, is to hand over the whole belief system to the grace of God, all the future, and say, here, you give back to me whatever is helpful to go beyond belief. So we can do that also. Choosing a new idea is the perfect step, because then you're experiencing unconditional love continuously, and the events of the world have no effect on your experiencing at all. And if those many will not choose to do that, seems a little too drastic, then we can turn over our future to the grace of God. And some won't want to do that completely, but to some extent they'll do that. And to the extent they do that, the consequence of the future will be softened for them, will be softened. Theoretically, everyone can do it, theoretically. Practically speaking, it doesn't look like that's going to happen at all. It doesn't need to happen. Doesn't make any difference. There's no consequences to reality if we don't all accept reality right now. There's no consequences at all. Reality remains exactly as it is, whether we choose to be aware of it or not. It makes no difference to reality. But clearly, there are many in this world who are going ahead with the plan of salvation, of belief, belief's plan of salvation. And they're pretty good at trying to disguise it, at least from themselves. I mean, everyone's very good at fooling themselves. They certainly haven't disguised it from me and others who can see us all like blatant, completely obvious, always wondering, going around this world just observing everything. I say, how in the world do these people really think that I'm so stupid that I don't see what they're, you know, what they're doing? It's ridiculous. It's like completely obvious, and yet they're pretending like, no, that nobody knows what's going on. This is all like, we're building a wonderful future by doing all this kind of stuff. And I said, no, you're building a funeral pyre, is what you're doing. You're stacking the logs on a funeral pyre, you know. And they're pretending, no, we're building the new temple, the temple of the new golden age. And I said, what are you talking about? You're building a sacrificial fire. It's completely obvious. And they say, we're singing happy songs. It can't be that. And we're sprinkling flowers on it, you know, and perfume water, and we're doing all this. Can't be a funeral pyre. We got so many flowers around, you know. Got good music piped in. Can't be a funeral pyre. I say, what do you mean? It's a funeral pyre. Everybody's going to commit sati on the funeral pyre, you know. And people say, no. Look how happy everybody is. Look how great their lives are. They wouldn't do that. They're singing songs and being happy and eating and dancing. And come on. They're too happy to do that, aren't they? I say, well, it's not a question. It's a question of belief. Do they believe in belief? And if you believe in belief, you're going to commit sati on the funeral pyre. No question about it. You will feel you have no option. All that anybody in the world is doing is trying to prepare their psyche for the sati. You know, if you know what sati is, you can Google it. Or I can tell you, which is the, in India, it used to be that the wives of men that had died, the widows, when the man was cremated on a funeral pyre, they would have to join them on the funeral pyre, as would did the servants as well. A lot of times, you know, everybody had to go up and smoke together. So, in this world, everybody's gonna, you know, march up to that funeral pyre, that funeral pyre, and commit sati, and yet that, you know, so they're singing and dancing and trying to get into this mood. There's a certain mood that is used for that, like the widows in India would. That their friends, you know, they'd be feasting and dancing and music, and all these people, you know, bowing to them and worshiping them and telling them how great they were, and everything. And they'd get into this mood, you know, kind of like very delusional kind of mood. So then they would walk up into the flames and sit down. And so you look at the world and what they're doing, and it's obvious to me they're getting ready to commit sati. You know, get ready to voluntarily climb on the funeral pyre. Get fried. There's a certain mindset that you can notice it. It's obvious. It's this whole giggly, glamorous singing and dancing and feasting and giggling and getting all giddy and getting into this whole sacrificial mindset kind of that's really something. And sort of a blind following of authority and what seems to be politically correct and all this kind of stuff, where they feel this total obligation. There's no zero question about their motives or what they're doing. No question whatsoever. You know, it's that kind of thing. Their mind is shut down from any other avenue of the future. Their future is locked and loaded, you know, and they're just now trying to get themselves in some sort of euphoric state so they won't suffer so bad. And they believe, of course, that this will then bring them eternal bliss by doing this. Because they believe this will then empower the super weapon, which can force Prime Creator to change and make Spirit Prime Creator, and then we'll have, you know, endless eternal bliss. So they're trying to override their reluctance, trying to override it by getting into this locked-in and giddy state of frivolousness, and it's obvious. If there's someone who's not going to take part in that, they can look at it and say, hey, whole thing is totally obvious. But those who are engaged in it refuse to admit what they're engaged in, because they don't want it to stop. They don't want any second doubts. No second doubts allowed, which is what you're seeing in culture right now. It's called zero tolerance. Okay, this whole thing about zero tolerance is basically saying no doubts allowed. No doubts allowed. Because we realize that we might have second thoughts on this. And so those who are pushing this whole thing, the lunatics who are pushing this entire thing, the part of the belief system that's saying we got to push this sacrifice through, they are insisting, you know, they've structured everything so nobody can have any second doubts allowed. No, zero tolerance to anything that might cause anyone to waver. And we have all these Harlequin, you know, Pied Pipers leading the way right up to the funeral pyre, you know, all with all their antics, you know, and debauchery, and all this, you know, the whole thing is just like this debauched procession, you know. Everybody's just in this, you know, lunatic condition, really, not tolerating any words from the onlooker saying, "Hey, what are you doing? You know, pull out of the procession here. You're simply, you know, going to your death for no reason. It's futile. It's useless." No, that's not allowed, really. Not really. There might be a few people calling out, you know, like right here, but it's not encouraged at all. And like I said, I wouldn't be able to do what I'm doing if I hadn't have given at least some of the consequences of the future over to divine grace already, which has protected me. Because there have been quite a few incidents that were set up to look like accidents that weren't accidents at all. I mean, I was able to see the whole thing and said that was totally pre-planned, but very artfully done, so nobody would suspect. You know, it's very clever. Belief is very clever. The whole system of existence is very clever in how it functions. And yet, if you're simply observant and don't believe in belief, you're able to see it. You're able to see it. Because you have tolerance for opposing viewpoints. You have tolerance to seeing the totality of the situation, to consider what's going on. You're not trying to engage in sacrifice. So you're having second doubts about it. You're saying, wait, I don't think I want this. I don't really want this. So you're having second thoughts. And therefore you're able to see much more clearly, okay, what's taking place in the world. Much more clearly. Those with zero tolerance, they're just thinking that they're having a hoot, you know, grand old time. They're just saying, hey, you know, this is great. And so everyone's slapping each other's back and saying, yeah, this is great. We're heading into the golden age now. You know, it's called total denial. Like as they're walking up into the funeral pyre, they see the gates of heaven opening up. They think they're walking into a cool bath. You know, the power of belief. The belief is such that it can work in that way. It can work in that way. But we don't need to have belief work for us at all. We don't need it. We can have the grace of God work for us. And that is what we are doing here. We're able to spotlight and highlight the workings of this whole system, the sacrificial system, which is existence. Existence is a sacrificial belief system. And we are able to highlight that and look at it and ask ourselves, is that what we really want? And consider, hey, wait a minute, is this plan going to work? Is this plan of salvation going to work? We can ask ourselves that. Is this plan of sacrifice going to work? Are we going to develop a super weapon? And the answer is no, 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 it doesn't work. We will not develop a super weapon. And so why should we throw ourselves into the fire, right? Why should we suffer the consequences of a futile future? Why should we keep playing along with this futility? Why? There's no reason to. There's no reason to. It doesn't harm the effectiveness of anyone else, because if something's impossible, how can the effectiveness of reaching the impossible be harmed or be compromised or diminished in any way? How can we diminish zero? How can we diminish zero at all? We cannot. How can we diminish nothing? How can we diminish zero? How can we diminish futility, impossibility? We can't do anything to it. There's nothing there to do anything to. Nothing cannot threaten reality. The impossible cannot threaten reality. Reality cannot be threatened. There's nothing other than reality. There's nothing outside of reality. And yet the whole system of this world right now is such that it's really amazing how it seems to, you know, pull at us and pull us along like a stampede. You know, we're caught in a stampede, and even though we don't want to go along, the masses of the stampeding people, you know, push everyone else along, very much so. So it's not an easy situation. Yet those who do not want to go along with it, the grace is there to move them to the edges of the stampede. More and more to the edges, more and more to the edges, until some point they can finally get out of the herd altogether, get out of the stampede altogether, and then they're not stampeded. So it is kind of a process of getting over to the edges of that herd, right? Getting out of the middle, getting to the edges where it's the pressure's not so severe, and keep edging your way to the edges. It's like that. That's the process. Every day, try to get to the edge a little more, a little more, a little more, a little more, the edge of that stampede. So you don't feel the pressure so severe on you. And that's simply what I have done, so I can testify to it. There's no way I could be sharing this information with the world if I didn't step by step, bit by bit, every day, get a little closer to the edge, get away from the herd, be a little less pressured, feel a little less threatened, all of that. Not possible. I'd have to, you know, I've worked at it every single day, and that's what's required. And anyone can do that. You just kind of, it's like you're in a powerful current, and you try to get to the edge of the current more and more, closer to the bank, closer to the bank, closer to the bank, and finally you can climb out on the bank and you're not in the river at all. And it's like that too. But if you're in the main current, you're going to be swept downstream for sure. In other words, you're going to experience the consequences of downstream. It's like we're in a river, a mighty river, that is sweeping us downstream very quickly. Now, let's say you are in an airplane up on high, and you look down on the river, and you could see the river for 100 miles downstream, you know, really a long, long, and you could fly over and you could see what's up ahead. And then let's say you then said, oh my gosh, you know, there's these monstrous waterfalls and cataracts coming up. Horrible. And so you flew back up the river, and you set the plane down, and you run to the bank, and you start yelling at everyone, hey, get out of the water, get out of the river, get out of the river, get out of the river. It's sweeping you down, you know, to these cataracts and waterfalls and crocodile pits and all this terrible stuff. And then people say, oh yeah, but the current's too strong. I say, well, start swimming towards the bank. Start getting out of the main current. Come on, swim, swim, swim. It's like that. It's just like that. Those in the main current, just swept along like that. And then go over the falls. All the while thinking that this is their salvation. And belief will let them believe that for a while, you know. But sooner or later, belief will say, hey, guess what? We need your help, a little more help again. And we know you're a hero, and we need the hero to have another deployment here. And back you go. And the, you know, the belief has all sorts of afterlifes, you know, beliefs also about what happens after the body dies, etc. And you can go to those places, and you think you're in heaven, you think you're in paradise. But you're not, because you will leave at some point that and be sent back into harm's way again. It's like a war. You have the troops, you know, at home. They're deployed. They go on deployment, and then they get some rest. They go back home, they get some rest and lead a fairly normal life, and then they get called up again for a second deployment, and back they go. Back they go into the hell of war. It's like that. People die, they think they go to a kind of nice R&R place, and it's seems pleasant enough, and then sooner or later, they get called back, identify with another body, here we go. Your sacrifice is needed again. Your country needs your sacrifice. That kind of thing. You know, belief needs your sacrifice. We haven't quite succeeded yet. That haven't been able to power up that super weapon. We haven't been able to quite assemble it. We need you to assemble it. We need you to power it up. We need your sacrifice to power it up and assemble it and all that. So, you got to do it. You got to do it. You can't quit until you succeed. That's what belief will tell you. That's what belief will tell you. Again, belief believes that you are its product, that it created you, it made you, that you are simply the child of belief. Belief will tell you that. That's what it believes. You can't change its belief. You cannot change its belief. No way. It will just kind of, you know, think like, huh, this child of belief I've made is kind of crazy, but it's still my child, you know. So it's futile to argue with belief. Completely futile. So you have to realize you're beyond belief. You're not a child of belief. You're the one who's doing the believing. Believing is your dream. The dream didn't make the dreamer. And yet that's what the dream is saying. The dream is the one making the dreamer. So that's why that we keep being bullied about in this dream and told we have to redeploy. Got to go through the sacrifice. Got no choice. Have to do it. But if we realize we are not a child of belief, that we're the dreamer of the dream, we can set the dream down. We don't have to believe in it anymore. We don't have to believe in belief. Because what we are doesn't require belief to be what it is. No belief required. None. Not good belief, not bad belief. No type of belief is needed. None. It's not like belief is the frosting on the cake of what we are. What we are doesn't need any frosting on the cake. So we're entering the pivotal time. So this is the pivotal teaching. We're focusing on what is pivotal. Always have been, but we're trying to get more and more and more out of the main current of that, you know, out of the herd. More and more off to the side. More and more off to the side. And I'm certainly praying that I'm able to get off even more to the side, you know, really off to the side. And then from there, keep encouraging everyone to come on, hurry up, get off to the side as much as possible. Start to assert your rights, your truth, that you're not a child of belief. Assert it. Not by saying you can change belief. You cannot change belief. Belief believes in belief. It will always believe in belief. You cannot change that, but you can choose a new idea where belief doesn't arise. You don't need any belief at all. You don't need to believe in unconditional love to be what it is. It is what it is. You don't need to believe that it's unchanging because it is unchanging. You see, it's the desire not to change reality gives rise to the effect which is unchanging, inherently unchanging. It doesn't require any effort on our part whatsoever. We simply abide in it. That's all. That's all that's required. So we are putting the pedal to the metal here as we go towards October, which is all important. Have to do it. Even if there's some unpleasant aspects to speaking this, have to do it. If we don't put the pedal to the metal, we're going to suffer the consequences of the future. And that we won't like that at all. And again, as you realize you're going to suffer consequences, what you'll do is you'll get into that denial complex of, you'll be swept up in trying to get this, you know, fake euphoria, you know. All the stuff, we use all the stuff, as people are doing now, you know, constant sex and drugs and drinking and partying and singing and dancing and eating and indulging in hedonism and all that kind of stuff. People are getting more and more into that kind of thing, this whole mood and attitude. Sort of a frenzy sort of thing. And they're seeing all these movies that full of destructivity and making all these special effects, and they're kind of like hypnotized by it, like, wow, you know, I want to be part of this. I'm part of this whole thing, scenario. There is an entire sacrificial mindset that's at play in the world right now. It's completely obvious. You know, and people get tired, they're getting tired, saying, man, I just can't keep partying, you know. And then people say, oh, here, let's pass out all of the Viagra, you know, keep everybody, come on, keep going. Keep getting yourself, you know, into this mindset that you're really, you know, it's like people walking into the cannon fire and they think they're walking, they're hallucinating that they're walking into some beautiful, you know, oasis or something, yeah, as they walk right into the cannon fire. They think, oh, the, you know, the soldiers think the cannon is a beautiful woman, you know. they got themselves, you know, so messed up in their mind, you know, such a party atmosphere. They say, oh, look at that beautiful woman, you know, the cannon, kaboom. Or the fire is a, you know, like a beautiful woman or something, or it's some beautiful place. And here, oh, I want to embrace that beautiful place. And it turns out to be a fire, a funeral pyre. It's like that. People are getting into insanity. It's become, you know, it's the fad. It is the culture. It is a culture of self-destruction. Self-destruction has become fashionable in the world. That is really what's really happening. And I know a lot of people are so upset about it. Say, what in the heck is going on with our culture? It's becoming self-destructive. Self-destructivity has become a fad, a fashion. It is now the ultimate fashion statement to be self-destructive. And those who are most self-destructive, they're the ones who, like, everyone's like, wow, what a role model. You know, what a role model. Look how self-destructive they are. How cool. Oh, that's cool. Wow. You know, someone blew themselves up. Oh, wow. Someone committed suicide. Oh, wow. Look at that. Huh. What an interesting role model. You know, someone's really crazy, destructive. Wow. How fashionable. That's kind of fad. And people are getting hooked and hooked and hooked and hooked into this. More and more hooked into it. And of course, many know exactly what's being said here. It's just the problem is what to do about it. That is what these videos are actually focusing on. I mean, many know what's going on. They don't quite see how severe it is, or how deep-rooted it is, or how the intention is so rooted and so determined. And they think they can turn the tide. They think they cannot turn the tide. It's not like that. But they can sidestep it. It's a different thing. You can't stop the current of a river. You can get out of the river, however. The river of existence is ceaselessly flowing. It's ceaselessly flowing into destruction. But you can't change that. However, you can get out of the river and sit on the bank for a while and then leave it behind altogether. Many will go to the side of the river, and there in the relatively calm, they'll sit there for a while. And they need to anchor themselves to the bank because the currents can come along and sweep them along, even though they're near the bank. And after a while of kind of sitting in the near the bank, they'll get out a little bit and they'll keep their feet in it, you know, because they're not really sure what being on the bank is like. And eventually they'll get out of the river altogether, move up on the bank high up so a flood coming down won't sweep them away. So it's a gradual thing, but it doesn't have to be attenuated, carried out too long. It doesn't need to be extended too long. It doesn't need to be drawn out. It can take place fairly quickly, actually. It's a funny thing that the morality and ethics of the world of class of Western civilization and world civilization has been under unprecedented attack by the sacrificial mindset, as if it has no basis, you know, as if it's old fashioned, like it was all some kind of control thing or something, you know. Now, the reason why we've had all these strictures and scriptures and rules and ethics and morality is to prevent us from getting into that sacrificial mindset as much as possible. Try to, you know, prevent that from happening. Because so nowadays, you can tell the determination of the sacrifice that's coming is so important to belief that it is frantically trying to dissemble and destroy and termite all of these values that we've had, which mitigate against this sacrificial mindset, you know, decency, high morality, civility, you know, no gambling, you know, it's very strong taboos against all sorts of degenerate activity, no prostitution, no gambling, should be no drinking, no drugs, no sex out of marriage. You know, all this kind of stuff, and then no contraception, no abortion, all these things were designed to prevent the sacrificial mindset that has arisen in this world, which leads to massive sacrifice. Because people will say, wait a minute, you know, there's consequences to my behavior. I need to really stay calm. I cannot get swept up in passion. I cannot, so people stay away from it. Instead, they start swimming towards the shore. See, but nowadays all that stuff is being presented as oppressive, bigoted, you know, intolerant, old-fashioned, ignorant, superstitious, stupid, etc., etc., etc. Of course, it's under unprecedented attack, and that should alert you to what is coming, because the belief is hell-bent on this massive sacrifice, and it wants to get the whole world into it. It wants to sweep the whole world away, so it sends these, you know, monsters of pop culture into the world that try to make self-destruction trendy, very trendy and cool and sexy, you know, all of that, grotesque. You know, it's all this horrible, grotesque decay, sickness, self-destructivity is presented in its high fashion. This is cool, kids. This is, you know, kids, this is what you want to do if you want to be popular. That's what the kids are thinking. And kids, of course, are desperate to fit in and be popular. And so they're going to, you know, be interested in what is trending. And all you see that what's trending is this horrible self-destructive mindset and preparation. And the kids think that this is what is cool. This is what we do to be popular, to be successful, and all this kind of stuff. And those who are saying, no, don't do that, kids. Squares, old-fashioned, bigots, you know, intolerant bigots or something, whatever. You know, something very, very vile and bad that they're trying to interfere with the happiness of the kids, the happiness of the people, that they're religious fanatics or something, all that. But if you see what's really going on, then you realize, you know, what the game really is. And what it is there are many in this world who say, hey, we don't really need sacrifice. We don't need it. We don't, what we are doesn't require that. And they don't want to go through with it. Say, forget it. No. So, and they're trying to warn others, you know, and they're fighting, it seems to be a losing battle. The culture wars, you know, have been vicious over the last 50 years. Absolutely vicious. When we talk about wars, like World War I, World War II, the fact is that the culture wars that have been taking place for the last 50 some odd years are much more vicious than World War II ever was. Way more. It's a much more consequential, severe war, because it's literally paving the way for planetary sacrifice and nonstop trauma here. It's paving the way. So in that regard, it's much worse war, the culture wars. And unfortunately, the bad guys are winning, meaning the sacrificial mindset, the preparation for sacrifice, the belief that this is somehow required of everyone, and this is the right thing to do, this is salvation, etc. That is winning the day. You know, it's gotten into our children, a couple generations now of children have been brought up on this almost entirely. And of course, those who disagree with this and recognize that that's not salvation, they're getting older. Most of the older people are getting older. There's some young people waking up to it also. They realize that, hey, this is a trap. This is terrible. I don't want to go with that. Lots of young people, but they're under a lot, so much pressure, you know. I understand that. Older people understand what the pressures youth are under. No question, because we've been through it all too. I mean, I got totally pressured when I was young. And did all sorts of things I didn't want to do, just try to be popular, you know, so I wasn't completely ostracized, which I was, you know, basically ostracized anyway, because I wasn't interested in sacrifice, so wasn't interested in belief, wasn't interested in time, none of that. So when you're young, you do get pressured, and you do things you don't really want to do. Again, try to fit in so you're not ostracized. But as much as possible right now, take a pass on all that stuff. You know what they say, later, you know, I'll catch up with that later. Just say that. It's very important when you're pressured not to take an absolute stand when it's difficult for you. But just say, you know what, I'm going to catch up with that later. A little bit, not right now. I'm not able to do it right now. Okay, always you can use that. Say, not right now. Say, yeah, sure, later, no problem, but not right now. Put it off. All that stuff, you know, that you know is gearing your mind, making your mind vulnerable, making you vulnerable to belief. And belief is always belief in sacrifice, inherently. Making you vulnerable to belief. Making you vulnerable to believe that you are a child of belief. All of that, you say, not now. Not now. Not right now. Not right now. No matter what it is. You know, no matter what it is, all the partying, all that, the thrills, all that stuff, say, not now. Stay totally sober right now in all regards. In all regards. Stay away from any sort of thrills, you know. Stay sober. Stay focused. Keep your inquiry going. Okay, do inquiry all the time. All the time. Anything that pulls you away from that, say, well, wait, not right now. I'm not able to do it right now. We'll catch up with that later. You might have the most beautiful partner in the world, you know, saying, oh, come on, let's go party together. You know, we'll party for the rest of eternity. Come on. And you say, not right now. No, not right now. But we'll do it later, but not right now. Yeah, you have to do that. Because you're going to have the party meisters, you know, coming at you from every angle now. And they're saying, hey, come on, let's party. You know, the world is under unbelievable assault by these people who are using their bodies, you know, to try and entice people to get into the sacrificial mode. And they're willing to use their bodies like prostitutes, whores, with no shame whatsoever. And they say, hey, come on, party with me. Let's party. And you just say, hey. Yeah, it looks great. That looks great, but you know, I'll do it later. But you know, catch up with that later, catch up with that offer later. But I'm not able to do it right now, not right this moment. You know, and you have to say that. And they'll say, ah, what's the matter with you? You're crazy. You say, oh no, nothing wrong with it. Nothing wrong. No judgment. Not being judgmental. Just not right now. So don't get into an argument with these people because they're insane. They really are, you know, in the grip of severe insanity. Sacrificial belief. They believe that they're children of belief, and they believe in the plans of belief. They believe in belief's plan of salvation, which is sacrifice, and they believe that your sacrifice is your salvation also. So they're trying to tempt you, to pull you into that sacrifice, and they believe that they're saving you by doing that. And you know they're insane, but don't argue with insanity. Just agree with them. Jesus said, agree with your adversary. You have to do that. Just say, yeah, that's cool, it's great. No judgment here, no intolerance here. But I'll catch up with you later. All right, and then we'll check in a little later, right this moment, right now. No, but later, hey, we'll see, you know. All right, that's how you sidestep it. I mean, that's pretty much how I did it too. I had to say, no, right now. Don't argue with them. Don't argue. You know, the internet's full of people who are arguing back and forth. Forget it. That's not the way. You'll never convince them anyway. It's fuel, a waste of time. Just agree with your adversary. Agree with your adversary and say, yeah, sounds great. Looks cool. Wow. Let's just party forever, huh? Yeah, okay, but I can't start right this minute, okay? So, a little bit later, maybe we'll see. Of course, they won't be happy about that, but they cannot really do much about it. They just say, you know, and then you just go on with your inquiry. They'll pressure you. They say, why, what's so important? You know, what's so important? What else is so important? They'll try to dig into your life, and you just have to say, just circumstances right now. I'm not able to do it, but we'll get back to that a little later. It's got a few things, you know, got to take care of first. You know, just say stuff like that. You just got to put them off. You just have to put them off. Super hard to do for young people, even for older people. Super hard to do. I've had situations where I've been, you know, even recently targeted. You know, like it's like scary. You have people, you suddenly realize you're being targeted. Younger people, you know, that never would be, you'd think, what in the world are they targeting me for, you know? No, because there's people in the world who will target everybody here. They want to pull everybody into sacrifice. And that's what they've prepared for. They prepared themselves to have no shame, no morals. No morals whatsoever. As I say, there's a total whorish mentality in the world, really. There really is. And there's so many people in the world who are willing to have that whorish mentality to pull people into sacrifice. And they're shameless about using that and targeting people. You got to be very careful right now. Really very careful. Scary. If you give any indication of vulnerability, boom, you're going to find yourself targeted. It's like when you say, whoa, what's happening here? Whoa, that is weird, you know. Anything to get past your defenses. If you're like a young person, you might have some older person targeting. If you're an older person, you might have a younger person targeting you. Anything that seems like out of reach before, suddenly you think, oh, it's within reach now. You think, huh, maybe. And then you say, no, not now, not anything now. Nothing but inquiry right now. If you don't have to say inquiry, it's just engage in inquiry. Put the pedal to the metal. And you can do it. Everybody can do it. You don't have to be going to concerts, listening to music, going to friends' houses, hanging out, partying, going to movies. You know, you don't have to do that right now. You can do it later. Do it later. Anything other than inquire, you can do later. If you need to, right? If you need to. And of course, later on, you'll find out you don't need to. So, right? You don't need to suffer any consequences to be what you already are. You don't need to learn any lessons to be what you already are. You already are what you are. You already are perfect. Okay, it's like that. And this light is ever-changing here. As the sun moves, you see, the light is ever-changing. So this world is ever-changing now, and yet you can stay in one place, like I am, and adjust, keep adjusting to the changing situations, and continue on. I'm able to continue on with the inquiry here, even though the lighting conditions are shifting, and I'm changing the adjustments, still continuing on. So you can continue on with your inquiry, with your clarification, with getting to the edge of the river, getting out of the herd, getting to the edge of the herd. Give over your future as much as possible to divine grace, to whatever you feel is a, if you want to use a personification of divine grace, you can do that too. And continue on with that. Continue on with that as much as possible, as fast as possible. Don't wait now. Don't wait. Don't say, I'll do it after the election. We'll see what happens. No, don't wait. Don't wait. October is the time to do it full time. October is full time now. Just see how far you can go. Just see how far you can swim towards the bank of the river, you know. How much progress can you make? Make it like a challenge, something that's interesting. Say, okay, let's find out. Let's find out how far we can go. And, you know, practically speaking, we'll procrastinate a little bit. We won't, you know, just push it completely because we don't want to look like we're panicking or anything. But you have to, that's built in. So you still have to go as fast as possible, you know. Realizing that most will not be doing it 24 hours a day. Because I don't want to give any evidence of being scared or panicked or like, who me? You know, I'm not trying to go against anything. I'm not trying to get to the side of the river. not really swimming there, you know. Just have to make, you know, kind of gradual progress. It doesn't really look like you're really swimming real fast. But you have to be, it's time to do that. It is, I'm telling you, it is time to do that. Right now. Man, we're hitting it hard today, this weekend. Leading up to October. And for some people, these videos help them focus in. You have to have some focus. You know, just don't want to drift. Don't want to drift. Don't let yourself drift. Wherever you can find that focus that is helping you, you know, get out of that main current there and off to the side there. Get into it. Get into it and use it, use it, use it. Now, it's theoretically I could make videos just constantly, but, you know, it's tough for people just to watch videos constantly. And when I'm not making videos, I'm not really sure what to do. That's my problem. But this is my means of really focusing in. And I look at other videos, I'm looking for other teachers' videos, various things, but it doesn't really grip me that much. There's a lack of urgency. I think the most important aspect of these videos is the urgency. I've always been about urgency, and people have always said, why are you so intense? Why are you so urgent? And pretty soon we're going to find out why. I really feel the ones who are helping the most are the ones who are imparting a sense of urgency. And my teacher certainly did that with me. Always. That's all I got. Urgency. You know, don't sit around, don't fool around, don't rest on your laurels for a single moment. Swim as fast as you can. And keep swimming. Get to the edge of that herd as fast as possible and keep at it. Don't hang around with those who are lackadaisical and, you know, no. Just go for it. So, you can go for it now. Just go for it. You got my permission. You have the permission of divine grace, of reality. They're all saying, go for it. And of course, belief is saying, you don't need to believe in that. Belief is giving you what it calls its grace, saying, take it easy. That's belief's grace, is take it easy. Be lazy. That's the kind of, because belief says, there's nothing to worry about. You know, what are you worried about? You're in the current, the river's carrying you downstream, everything's going to be great downstream. Why you need to worry about anything? You know, why the urgency? No need. Because it believes in its plan of salvation. It believes that sacrifice will empower, you know, a super weapon. So it believes that, it believes everything's fine for you. No reason to worry at all, it says. And it thinks that you're under a state of grace when you're that way, when you have no urgency. No urgency as you're being carried down the stream. Now, of course, those who are out of the river entirely, sitting on the bank, you know, they have no fear of any consequences, so they have no urgency vis-a-vis that. But they do have an urgency, impart that to us who are still in the river. They impart the urgency to us. Come on, come on, come on. Whereas belief just says, hey, what's the big deal? No worries, you know, everything's fine. It's only life. It's only existence. It's only a river. Who, you know, what's the big deal? Don't get into that, you know. That is really the worst mindset. Everything's going to be fine. The future's great. Future's great. Don't worry about those naysayers. They're crazy. Everything will be fine. Everything most definitely will not be fine. Belief is very serious about its business, and it carries out its business. It knows how to take care of its business, and it's really going to take care of its business now, because you can tell it set it all up. It wouldn't, you know, if all this setup had never not taken place, we wouldn't, then we, you know, the worry would not be so extreme. But it has taken place, and so you know what belief is up to. You know it. You know what its business is. And it most certainly will take care of its business. So you most certainly don't want to be believing that you're a child of belief at this time. No way, no how. Never want to believe that. Never want to fall into belief at all. And again, belief inherently believes you're a child of belief. So it's not like you can have a counter belief. You can't say, well, I believe I'm not. That's not good enough. Because it's still belief. So you have to literally know it. You have to know it. You have to own it. You have to own it. So we're working toward ownage. Momentum. October, momentum. Maybe November is ownage. Okay. Let's go and look at it that way. Here we are. We're going fast as possible, gaining momentum, and then at some point we're going to be able to say, okay, we're going to own this, what we're about. We're going to own the fact we're not a child of belief. We're going to own the fact that we are a child of isness. We're going to own that. So we're working towards ownage. Not belief, not just believing that we're not a child of belief, but knowing that we're not. And knowing what we are a child of, and owning that. And not trying merely to make a belief out of it. Not going to belief and saying, hey, belief, guess what? You know, I found out I'm a child of reality. And belief will say, oh, really? Do you believe that? And you say, yeah, I believe it. And belief says, oh, okay, it's okay to believe that. And you think you've really made, you know, real proud. You've made belief think how great belief is, that the child of belief is now, you know, a great child of reality or something. Then you do that, you're lost. Because belief inherently believes that nothing is permanent. Okay? That is the problem. So, of course, belief will say, oh, you're a child of God, you're a child of reality. Oh, great. You believe that? Okay, just believe it. That's fine. No problems. See, belief then will, but belief won't tell you is that belief inherently does not believe that anything is permanent. And therefore, you will experience its wrath of its impermanence. Okay? Impermanence of belief. Everything is impermanent to belief, and it will make you a example of. It'll make an example of you. It builds you up to tear you down. Whereas reality is permanent. See, so you cannot believe that you are a child of reality and not suffer the consequences of belief. Make an example of you that it's impermanent. You have to own it. You have to know it. You have to experience it. Beyond belief, beyond the impermanence. Only belief is impermanent. So that ownage is all important. You have to own it, and you cannot try to give it back to belief and say, here you go, belief. Here's something greater to believe in. No, because no matter whatever belief believes in, however great we think it is, it's impermanent. Belief will attack it and destroy it. That particular belief, that concept. All concepts are crushed. Because belief has to believe in impermanence, that reality is impermanent, meaning that it can be threatened, it can be attacked, and we can force that change that we're looking for. Wow. So as we get this momentum, also start thinking about ownage, that we're owning it. We're not a child of belief. There's nothing about us that comes from belief. Nothing whatsoever. No None of reality comes from belief. None of it. Never will. And belief inherently is a belief in impermanence, that reality can be changed. That is the foundation, the premise of belief. And effects cannot leave their premise. Belief systems cannot leave their premise. It's impossible. So whatever lies belief will tell you, like, oh, yeah, okay. No. Belief will always believe in impermanence. So whatever belief you have, it will believe that that belief is impermanent. You have the belief that you're the child of divinity, that belief will be impermanent, be attacked and crushed. There's a lot of people in the world who think that they're enlightened, who believe they're enlightened, who believe, you know, that they're child of the divine, who believe they're on the path to enlightenment, who believe all this stuff. So there's a lot of belief in all this. But that is the booby trap. That is the trouble. You have to go beyond belief, because you will find these beliefs get absolutely trashed. Absolutely trashed. There's a lot of people who believe in the guru, believe in Jesus, believe in this and that. You have to go beyond the belief, because the belief will be trashed. At some point you'll be sobbing and crying and say, none of my beliefs came true. You know, like, I don't believe in them anymore. I don't believe in Jesus anymore. I don't believe this and this and that, you know. Because you have to go beyond belief to abiding in the experience of reality of isness. Now you can, that's why I say giving your future to the guru, to the savior, to the grace of God is so important. Because they know that you're not a child of belief. And they know their clarity doesn't come from belief at all. So they're not going to reinvest your future for you. They're not going to invest your future in belief at all. They're going to disinvest from in belief for you. It's like an investment advisor, you know. You hand over your portfolio to them and they, you know, make the advice of you know, they're in charge of the investments and you trust that they're going to make the right investments. Grace of God will not invest your future in belief at all. And ultimately, by not investing in belief, you'll realize you don't even need a future. Don't even need a future. Ultimately, you'll realize that. So that's another super important aspect of the times we live in right now. We have momentum. We have choosing a new idea. We have ownage, going beyond belief. We also have giving the future to the grace of God and letting the grace of God invest in our future. It will not invest in belief for us. It will disinvest in belief. Even the highest belief, the most dangerous beliefs are the highest beliefs, really. The ones we think that are the best beliefs, those are the most dangerous ones. I certainly know those who believe that they're Christ, they believe they're Jesus, they believe this, they believe that. Those are the most dangerous beliefs. Anyone who says it believes that they're Jesus is in a very dangerous situation. It's a danger to themselves and others. Because that's not going beyond belief. That's believing that somehow some high belief is separate from the premise of belief. It's not true. Only those who know that I am presence of isness, who are abiding in that, only those who have gone beyond belief, and they're not in any danger from belief at all. They don't need to say I'm Jesus or I'm Christ or I'm all this stuff. You know, if they want to, it doesn't make any difference. It's what is Christ. I am presence of isness, the isness, identity, spiritual identity is what we call Christ. It's not a person. It's not a form. It is the I am presence of isness. That's what it is. It is what it is. It is the isness itself. It's formless. And yet it can present itself in any form, if need be, to help. So, you know, saying, you know, there's no reason to say I am anything in particular, just I am. I am. Isness is. Isness is. There's no one being the isness. Isness is. There's no guru being the isness. It's the isness. It is simply is. And the guru is just a transparency overlay of that fact. So don't get pulled into gaudy, glamorous, high beliefs. You know, I believe I'm the someone says they believe they're reincarnation of Jesus on earth, or reincarnation of this, or they believe all this stuff. No. It's completely obvious. Any appearance of isness is completely obvious. The isness is. They're not, there's nothing that needs to be said at all. They're just radiating that assurance that the reality can't be threatened. Isness is, reality can't be threatened ever. That's it. And it's completely obvious. They're not believing in anything. They don't need any belief. And isness really cannot reincarnate anyway, because it was never here in the first place. It was never part of belief in the first place. So it can animate another, transparent meat suit. But it never was that transparent meat suit in the first place. So the whole idea of reincarnation of some, guru or something is pretty meaneless. It's just the isness appearing with a transparent meat suit once again. The meat suit doesn't matter. How can we say that the meat suit reincarnates? It's meaningless. Meat suit is just neutral. So it's a meaningless statement. And isness, doesn't need to reincarnate. It's always been what it is. It didn't go out of incarnation. It didn't come into incarnation. It didn't go out of incarnation. It just remained as it is. That's all. And sometimes it puts on a transparent meat suit so we can seemingly relate to it as if it were not everywhere already. Constantly changing, isn't it, the world? Constantly changing. Constantly adapting to these changes, right? The same hand always staying on point, saying what needs to be said. Reinforcing it over and over again from all sorts of angles. Continuously reinforcing it. Continuously. Hoping for a magic bullet, realizing that where we're at right now, there's no real magic bullet. The current's strong, pulling us downstream. The magic bullet is effort. Continuous effort is the magic bullet. That is how what works. Don't get fooled by those who say, no. We don't need to do any of that. It's simple. You just, this is all you have to do. Boom, got it. Okay, that's it. They're just believing, They're just saying, all you have to do is believe that you're enlightened and you're enlightened. See, that's the problem. That's a trap. Just believe in nothing. Believe you're I am, or believe you're nothing, or believe this. All you have to do is just right now, drop all objections to this belief. That's not it. Going beyond belief is it. And owning that is it. And it's something that we have trepidation towards. And again, as I explained, the belief has this belief in salvation, its plan, and belief is pressing this on you to the utmost extent, and it fights against you tooth and nail to prevent you from going beyond belief, because it literally doesn't believe it's possible. Okay, it literally does not believe that it's possible for you to go beyond belief. It has no belief. It says that's impossible, and any thought that you can, you're just completely insane. And so it tries to help you come out of that insanity by stop believing in it. So there is this adversary that we have, and it's a ferocious adversary, really. And it's 100% disbelief. It says it's impossible to go beyond belief. You're a child of belief, so how can you ever separate from that? Because then it invokes the idea that cause and effect cannot be separated. But what it doesn't realize is belief itself is a belief that cause and effect can be separated. And by saying that you're beyond belief, it's your rejection that cause and effect can be separated. That's the truth of the situation. So belief has it completely upside down and backwards. When it claims that you're trying to separate, no, you're trying to reject the notion of separation. Say it's not possible. Therefore, we need to jettison belief because it's trying to accomplish the impossible. That is where it's at. That is the truth of the situation. So belief will absolutely bully you, bully you, bully you. And it can, you can step beyond it, but you certainly, in lieu of that, you do have to be working really hard at inquiry. Don't just think, oh, you know, it's so simple, I don't need to even work at it. Because belief is ferociously working against you at all times, ferociously. So as you take it easy, you're simply allowing belief to the fire of belief to come back and start burning you again. And belief will tell you, oh, that, hey, no, this is all good. This is helping you. And you think, oh, I'm being helped. Okay, no problem. Belief will say, take it easy, take it easy, take it easy. It's all so simple, take it easy. No, that's not true. Don't take it easy. Work as hard as possible. And realize you can step beyond belief. You can get closer to it. Don't be discouraged if you don't, because very few in this world have actually gone step beyond belief. However, you can get closer and closer and closer as it is, and get more and more resolve, and ultimately you can do that. You can give some of your future to a guru, to grace of God. You can give all of your future to the grace of God. You can get away from the herd. You can get away from the stampede. You can do all those things, and eventually you will step out of belief, beyond belief entirely. You will do that for sure. But don't think it's something that is going to be easy for you and you're going to do it, and so you don't have to even work at it. That's no problem. That's doesn't go like that. You can believe it goes like that. Belief will tell you, oh yeah, you can do that. But again, belief believes you're a child of belief, and it is 100% certain of it. It believes it entirely. And you have to step beyond that false certainty. False certainty. And that's hard to do. Because we think we're rejecting certainty, which we don't want to reject. See, it's this kind of double bind kind of thing. We have to step beyond the fake certainty of belief into the true certainty of reality. And yet there's this point where we think maybe we'll be without any certainty at all. So it is this, you know, pivotal point of fear there. And it can be done. It has been done. It will be done. And this is a good time to bring an end to this video. And keep on with your inquiry. Just keep your head down. Just keep on moving. Keep on trucking with it. Keep on trucking. It's getting there. Momentum in October, owning it in November. You have some goals there, so stay with it. All right. Very great. That's it for this video.